As you know, that the council, the city had its first council meeting on the 11th of February that couldn't finish, as you know, because of COVID restrictions and things like that. So it had to continue on the 15th, this yesterday. And these are among the decisions, key decisions that have been taken. Of course, you have been given already the document pack, I'm informed, by the communication team. So what we're just trying to take you through is the key decisions that have been taken from the 11th to the 15th of February. One is the city approved the pre-allocation of land to households on the city's waiting list and the informal settlement upgrading areas. Pre-allocation of land is an initial allocation of land based on the proposed layout plan, meaning the layout that is supported by council and obtained environmental clearance but did not yet clear the statutory planning processes. The allocation will be done in line with council development and upgrading policy on allocation of land in these specific areas. It is worth noting that for nearly a decade, the delivery of service land in the informal settlement almost ground to halt, mainly due to the lack of funding and protected land development value chain. The residents residing in the informal settlement and those on the waiting list are frustrated with the slow land delivery process that stands in their way for securing land tenure and its associated benefits. For instance, between 2000 and 2004, Ms. Amanda, if I'm not mistaken, during that whole process, there were only about 400 residents that were assisted from the list during that whole period. It's a period of about 6 to 7 years, so it's very slow. That takes to you about 50 residents per year from the list. So we had not been moving from that. That is why this method is invoked now, the method of pre-allocation. So we must be able to explain to you what this means. And you now have pre-allocation takes place into, if you can just see on the two boards, you are able to see either on that screen or that, on the two screens. So you would see that it's written, for example, the F number, and first it's written in-house. What it means in-house, that those are the planning initiatives that have taken place through and by our own town planners. So they took the F number, that from 508, that portion of it, they did the planning and they discovered that 279 plots can be obtained from there. It is the same that they went to Havana in terms of 508, again 250. You see the two terms that are used there. One is brownfield, the other one is greenfield. The difference is that pre-allocation takes place at two levels. One, it is in terms of our upgrading of the informal settlement. So that when you do a planning intervention in the informal settlement, that's what is called the brownfield. Yeah, because there are already people who are there. There are already people who have occupied that. So, but in a place where there is nobody who have occupied that land, in other words, virgin land, is what is called the greenfield. So that is the greenfield. Wherever you see the greenfield, for example, the portion of this one here in Havana, for example, 267 plots or 230. So you see the type of land that is been identified. So the total amount of plots is 3,035 plots in-house. That what that means basically is that we have taken the land that we have in our control and we plan that land. Yeah. So the planning intervention is not, I see people who are talking about money and things like that. What is at play here is taking the plans, and once you take the plans, you then look at the list in terms of the greenfield. You then look at the list and see, and you do an allocation, a pre-allocation, to indicate to a person that, Lloyd Jason, you've been on our list, this earth so-and-so, in Ochomwise, in Havana, in Kuriangava, or wherever it is being allocated to you. So that you can then begin, so the council takes you into its confidence, so that you can then begin with the preparation, so that you can then begin with the planning, because you know where you are going to go, instead of just these random things that actually happen. So that first aspect there deals with what our team inside under the leadership of Mr. Manda. Those are the plots that have already been designed and prepared already. But there is one that is indicated they outsourced. Yeah? So outsourced, that basically means that the town planning activities and the layout are not going to take place inside. So we need an additional capacity. So you see there is written TBC to be confirmed. So the specific ELF numbers are not determined there as yet, because there's still a lot of planning initiatives that will have to happen by then. So council resolved that over the period of the 3,035 are the one in terms of our in-house planning mechanism. But over the next 3 years, the target is to pre-allocate 5,000 plots. So this intervention, of course, in line with the development and upgrading policy, this intervention is specifically meant to provide hope in a realistic manner, so that our people are eventually able to see what is going to be happening. So lesson is a bit complex, and if you have a question, Ms. Amanda will be able to entertain you on that further. So you need to understand the concept, what is basically happening. So we are not just going to go to the new areas, but we are also going to the informal settlement, realigning them, putting in the roads, putting in the schools, and doing all those things. And of course, for those people that are already in there, a planning intervention would have to be done. Now, the argument that we are also making with regards to the list is that, are those, Ms. Amanda, are those the intern?
Oh, yes.
For town planning?
Oh, yes,
all of them. Can you please, guys, come here?
Yes.
Mm. Yeah. So these young people that you are seeing here behind me, they have been brought in as intern. They are studying town planning. They will introduce themselves. So that, because we need to increase capacity for us to be able to do the layout, the planning, and all those interventions. Because remember, we are dealing with the informal settlement. We are also dealing with the open land that is called the greenfield. So we took a resolution as far as the list is concerned. Because remember what we're saying about the greenfield, in other words, the land that is not occupied, the land that's kind of a virgin land. So we, of course, you might have seen a debate, those of you that were following, some of you were not following properly, you were following while you were cooking. We want to explain to you what actually happens. There is a list in the Department of Property, and there is a list in the city. In other words, when people come and apply to the city, they register their names, and there's been acknowledgement letters and things like that. Now, what we have said is that we want to have a list with integrity, because we are going to use that a list as a basis. Of course, the principle that council approved is pre-allocation, but council also tasked the two departments, Mr. Manda's department and IT department, to clean up the list. What does clean up the list means? Clean up the list means that we need to ensure that those people who are on the list, are they deserving? Yeah? Or is it the person with 5 houses that is also on the list who's also applying? Because if you already have a plot in the city and there are people who don't have plots, why must you be in the list? So in other words, it's a very serious methodical and scientific method that we are going to use. So in other words, they must go to the deeds office and check whether these people who are on the list. So they clean up the list, they digitize it. We must have a soft copy of it, and we must also have a copy that comes to council. And then it's approved through MC and eventually through council, so that everybody knows a person who's at number 5, a person who's at number 20, and the person who's at number 500, and the person who's at 2,000. It must never be a speculation. It must never be an issue of saying this is in some computer. Everybody must be able to understand. And once this process is done of the list, we also want to have it on the city's website. Once it's on the city's website, you are even able to look and assess yourself where you are. And because the list will keep changing. If we are able to pre-allocate you, you build your house, you have signed a title deed, you obviously have to get out of the list. And then we are able to see the progress that we are making in terms of that specific list. We are very excited about pre-allocation because it's an intervention that has not occurred, and realistically people are able to say this is not some promises that people are making. This is the layout. You have seen the team and they are able to actually show you where is this land and that process is going to take place. Of course, once everything is in place, there will be a pre-allocation agreements that would have to be signed, and then there's going to be lease agreement, and eventually to the deed of sale. So it's just a process to say that instead of waiting for 2030, so let people already be able to plan and say, I have been pre-allocated this portion of land. It's like when you pass grade 10, or before you even write your exam, your father says that I'm going to apply for you to go to the University of Namibia. Once you go to the University of Namibia, you will have to live in the hostel, or then you start preparing already, because you have been positioned in a realistic path towards moving from point A to point B, where point B is a better place. Council took note of the deteriorating living condition in the informal settlement of Windhoek and the need for consistency in handling humanitarian land and shelter requests. Because there's been a random, you just hear a person whose house has been washed away, is a single mother who's suffering, there was a fire, there was a flood. So the city was approaching this issue of assisting the vulnerable people or people in unfortunate circumstances on an ad hoc basis. So what the council did is to adopt a framework. How do you deal with people who are asking for shelter on humanitarian ground? How do you deal with unfortunate situation? How do you deal with hazardous situation and things like that? So we discuss and put up the framework in terms of how is it that we are going to approach that specific issue. We also empowered the housing department to be able to do certain intervention, also to put up teams and committees, even on an ad hoc basis, how the management committee is also able to sit and to be able to address some of these specific issues. You will read the details in the statement once you then. I'm just giving you an orientation that there is a resolution taken by council. So when there's a flood, when there's a fire, when there's a hazard, when there's an unfortunate situation that occurs in Windhoek, we are not just going to show up as a CEO and take decisions randomly. We are going to follow a particular framework that has been approved by council to be able to respond to that. Of course, when you read and check that item, it also details and deals with some sort of controlled entry into unplanned area and in the informal settlement, so that we are able to have a specific intervention instead of the current framework where we just show up once we hear there is a complaint or something like that happened and we don't know how to also respond. The housing, of course, is not just, of course, you now see that the city, through this intervention of pre-allocation and many other interventions that are going to come, council takes a deliberate approach to get involved in housing instead of allowing the so-called invisible hands of the market to be able to determine rewards. But that doesn't mean that we also don't make provision for the private sectors and people who want to help and assist us. It is for that reason that new township establishment were approved yesterday. That is a township at Farm Ongos number 35, close to Havana Township, and is a project by the NHE. And this project, if it's carried out in terms of of what is proposed, is going to bring about 1,105 ervens that are going to be available in terms of that intervention. So we approved a township of the NHE, that side of Ongos. There's also another township that we have approved by Indigenous People's Business Forum. It's a company, but that's the name of it. Indigenous People's Business Forum. It is Avis. It's going to generate about 246 Ervin. So we do appreciate that the private sector will also assist us in this specific problem area of housing. The city of Windhoek renewed its membership with Alan. The resolution was taken, as you know, that the city of Windhoek, a capital city created in terms of Article 1 of the Namibian Constitution, took a decision some time ago that they are going to get out of the Association of Local Authority of Namibia. Now, Windhoek, you can look at Windhoek as a big brother. A big brother cannot get out of the house and assume and hope that the siblings, the younger siblings, would be able to handle the house very well. It is an unfortunate situation that the city had to find itself in a position with no other reason but to withdraw from Alan. So the decision has been taken, one, to go back to Alan. So we are renewing our membership to Alan. We are going to be paying our membership. So we are going to be part of Alan. But we are also saying that we want specific reforms. We don't want to find ourselves in the same situation again. Yes, we want to help Beseba. Yes, we want to help Katima Mulilo. Katima Mulilo can also probably help us. Yeah, Windhoek is, the tourists come here first. Somebody comes, we want to do an agricultural activity. We would simply say, why don't you go to Katima? There's a lot of water there. We are having a water problem. Yeah, we could do those type of intervention and things like that. But we want to provide a leadership to the local authority sector. But when we do that, there are certain things that we want to perform, them to be performed. So Alan must get its house in order. And council took a resolution that the leadership of the city must engage Alan for specific reforms. So we are not just going there, we are going to assist and transform the local authority sector, but we also want a credible institution, and we are going to be playing a leading role in terms of that. There is what is called a mayoral relief fund existing now. It is not registered, its operation is on an ad hoc basis. There's some funds that go there, and I think in that fund there's more than 1 million in that fund. So what council have decided that this mayoral relief fund be registered as a Windhoek Residence Mayoral Trust, so that it's able to assist to support the vulnerable community members and individuals who are in extreme need, and obviously the fund aims to address the challenges affecting the residents' social well-being and livelihood, among others. By this intervention, the city of Windhoek expressed readiness to continue its active contribution towards social progression by improving all residents' quality of life as articulated in its mission. The main aim is to register a trust that operates as a legal entity based on charitable fund principles, as well as a tool that the fund could use then to gain more recognition and also increase its revenue and attain assets and things like that. So you would read all the details in that statement, but suffices to say that the fund is no longer going to be on an ad hoc basis. Council has approved for this fund to be registered legally in terms of the trust deed that has also been approved by council. And of course, the trustees would have to be appointed. One of the councillors who also serve on those specific on the trust as part of the trustees to be able to provide leadership to that. There's a lot of people who want to contribute, but sometimes our bureaucratic processes do not assist. But sometimes people just want to make sure that their funds goes for the intended request. But once it goes to the main pool, some people are not comfortable with that. So it's to inform the residents that council have approved that a Windhoek Residence Mayoral Trust fund be registered with obviously the masters of High Court where these registers are discussed. You must have seen in the newspapers about the many, many donations that were done in response as a COVID response measure. These donations were done in terms of the existing cooperation agreements between the city and many other cities that has been taking place. Whether it was because it was an election year or just because of a mere bureaucracy, those donations, some of them are standing there. unutilized. There's about more than 100 toilets that are supposed to have gone to the informal settlement. So this council is not very happy with having toilets that are standing there idle when our people need those type of donation. And it's not just the toilets that has been donated by Bank of Namibia, Minister of Environment and Tourism, NAMPOWER, and you see the value of these donations in terms of that. But there's also some donation to the value of 125,995 euros that is donated by Windhoek Bremen Cooperation Agreement in terms of that context. But this is specifically for solid waste management. And there's a lot of, the Chinese made several donations, 700 pieces of protective cover uniforms to fight COVID, 5,000 pairs of disposable medical rubber inspection gloves to a specific value. This is the Chongqing city in China, is a sister city in China. But the city of Shanghai also donated the mask, 17,000 of them that are donated to the city. 40,000 facial masks are also donated by the sister city of Zhuhou in China again, and 30,000 facial masks donated by the sister city of Nijiang. Obviously, in terms of the local authority act requirements, you require ministerial approval for this. We don't understand why the previous council did not move with speed when it comes to some of these things. So, obviously, first council must accept those donations, which is what council have done at its meeting. Then after that has taken place, the second process must now continue of ministerial approval. We are committed and we will be making sure that those toilets are put up. In fact, some of us are also informally discussing that we will need to, all of us, put on our overalls. Instead of getting tenders and things like that, the employees of a city and people in the residents who want to help us to put up those toilets, 120 of them, we put them up in the same day. We deploy some of you to Joseph. You leave your camera, we deploy you to Wachomise to dig. On that Saturday, we dig and we dig. Obviously, the professionals will be there. There are some technical requirements, environmental clearance and all those things that has to happen. But we want to be able to, once these processes are done, we want to be able to move with speed. The disaster and the emergency is already dealt with in terms of the law. There's a specific law that deals with disasters. There's a whole procedure. How do you declare a local disaster? What procedures do you follow to declare that? So there's already a legal framework that deals with that specific issue. What we approved is to say that when there's a person whose home is washed away by the rain, so and the CEO shows up there, do you just make a decision because everyone else is emotional? So what we approved there is a standard operating procedures on what do we do in terms of those requests, but also a specific framework in terms of dealing with unfortunate cases and also hazardous cases, particularly when it deals with, because remember, is that the request is in the context. Once you look your council document, you must have been given those documents. If you are not, please get those documents. It is to deal specifically with in an area of land and shelter. That is what we're dealing with. So everything else that is not covered by the disaster, because we already have a disaster risk management team that do a lot of assessment, that provide briefings and things like that. The rest of the things are already clear in terms of that framework. What is, because remember that when the adopting a framework on how you do this, it doesn't immediately have financial implication. Because you are simply just saying, the officials, when there's a situation like this, this is what you do. When there's a problem like this, this is how you approach it. So the framework doesn't immediately generate any financial implication. It's basically just to say, we want to be able to regulate this sector so that you don't just show up in the area and then you don't know what to do. Because at times, the public is out there, it's in the newspapers, you don't know what to do, and the CEO does not know what to do, council is not in session. So that is the framework in which we wanted to be able to do. Yeah, it's the same thing with the request about the ministry. I don't know what has been the historical problem, but the approval that are done by the ministry, the approval processes would not just be done because the ministry wants to do the approval process. They will be provided for either by the Public Procurement Act in terms of land alienation or the Local Authority Act in terms of the budget of the particular local authority. So of course we had a meeting with the minister, and we emphasized the minister on that specific aspect of the budget to be able to say that we need to ensure that our budget is approved timelessly. And the minister have considered. Of course, they agreed, the officials, the executive director was also in that meeting. They agreed, particularly on that aspect of the budget. The township approval processes, again, in terms of the town planning, urban and regional planning, new is of the Act of 2018. So all those approval things are regulated by a statutory requirement and process that you must be able to do that. The question on when are the new people going to apply? There is actually provisions here in the city already, but what we are busy and concentrating on, we want the list to work. And once we finalize the list, we'll be able to communicate when are we going to continue rolling out. It's not our immediate focus. We want to clean up the list and what exists there. And obviously for you to, you can't want to clean and then you are bringing more. You need first to clean whatever it is that you have. The plots timeline, the Jemima, those 3,000 plots, those township are already, the land already exists as we're speaking. The planning scheme, and in fact, what I'm also beginning to see, Ms. Amanda, maybe you must write an article publicly just to be able to explain, because pre-allocation is very technical, and it seems that many people will not be able to understand immediately. That's why you find a person saying, we don't have money, but do you need to have money for the planning purposes, for you to deal with, to say this is the list and this is the plans? Then you do that. Then 3,000 from the list are now here. So we need to be able to explain and really go on a mass education campaign for so that our people can understand what is going to happen. Move. Remember, Loide, we indicated that the pre-allocation is going to operate at two level. We mentioned the brownfield. What this basically means that we don't want the informal settlement to remain the way they are. So what the department is doing, the department is having an intervention, a planning intervention. So you go, you take Onyika number one or number two, you take an aerial view to say this is our existing infrastructure, we need to put up a road there. But when you do that planning intervention, you don't necessarily check there is a shed here or you do what. You just do that. Immediately once you, then after that you go there and you do the pegging. You do, that's why you see those stars remove or so, because that's where the road is going to, the surveyors will now come to the ground and things like that. So what you then do, once you do a planning intervention, you then realign people and they must be allocated plots because those people are already there. So the upgrading of the informal settlement also have then that operation of pre-allocation for the informal settlement. It's not just, that's why you must make a distinction that pre-allocation works in terms of the new places, but pre-allocation also works in terms of upgrading the existing informal settlements so that you are able to, there is no crisis there or whatsoever. Time, we indicated that we want to be able to do 5,000 plots in 5 years. So in fact, in the, one of the resolution you see that on that particular item of pre-allocation, one of the resolution is that immediately there are some layout that already have environmental clearance, but there are others on that list that do not have environmental clearance. Now for those lists, for those ones that do not have environmental clearance, immediately what is going to happen, there is going to be an intervention. The leadership of the city will have to go to the environmental commissioner and be able to impress upon. Now, the certificate, recognition of certificate, is an intervention, a beautiful intervention, because remember this is happening in terms of the development and upgrading policy. So what that department have done, you would see when Mr. Manda is one of the, I don't know whether it's a risk of saying this, but I'm sure the chairperson agree. Mr. Manda is one of those employees that started from the bottom all the way until he became an SE. So over with the passage of time, he understood the problems that are there. So you could see that a lot happened. He became an SE in July 2019. So immediately after he becomes an SE, development and upgrading policy would be approved. So even as activists in my other life, we've been working with him when I was a manager of human settlement. So what they then did is that that intervention of certificate comes from that background. It is not necessarily the initiative of the official. The professionals wanted to say, no, we need to deal with the informal settlement. What do? We first recognize occupation. Once you recognize occupation, you give a person an ease of mind. Once you give them an ease of mind, you actually know for planning purposes how many people are in a particular area and what is their identity, to an extent that you would even know their gender and their socioeconomic.